catch 8.
Hey everyone, and welcome back to another video. Well, the theme of this week's news is really damn clear. Patch 8.1 is very soon. Blizzard have tweaked a bunch of stuff on the PTR. They've released a bunch of preview posts. But oddly, for a patch that's releasing in just a few days, a lot is still up in the air with us. Not exactly.
I want to actually say one other thing before I get into this. Belior, it's actually really great to see him losing his hair too, because then I feel like I'm not the only one. Is there any WoW YouTuber that hasn't lost their hair? There's like me, Preach, Belior. Yeah, I guess that guy, Swifty. Yeah, Swifty shaved his hair off. Fucking Nyxium, dude. Okay, fine.
Exactly being able to trust all the PTR data that's out there. Then the survival guide went up and it kind of got dislike bombed. So today we're going to get to the bottom of that
dislike
as well
bombed.
As cover what's up with patch 8.1. Still, new things are coming to Azeroth though.
Nice
there's
Thanks
a lot to cover,
man.
But first
Good
up, a shout out to the Patreon
Sorry
crew. Over there, there's early access, bunch of other cool stuff. There's also the art, which is extra awesome this month, and also there are vinyl stickers, which I appear to have lost.
Oh, and then
the Wrath of the Lich King documentary went up. It's like probably one of my favorite bits of content I've ever made. If you watch one video this month, I really hope it's that one.
It was a good
as
video.
Much as news and stuff is fun, stuff like that's really what I care about a lot. So yeah, thanks to the Patreons, and I hope you enjoy the Wrath of the Lich King documentary. With that, let's get into the news. We'll start off with a nice little light one, Paragon boxes.
Oh,
so, while the
good.
Few surviving Stormdrake hunters from Legion were able to successfully get Paragon boxes banned under the Geneva Convention, the mechanic has returned for Battle for Azeroth. Now,
this is a very nuanced perspective to have, and I want to go ahead and explain this right now, and these are my thoughts on Paragon boxes. The nature of farming world quests to get Paragon boxes, I don't think was necessarily bad. The reason why it would be bad in Battle for Azeroth is that there are no artificial ways to accelerate the way that you farm world quests. There are no longer the elite world quests that are blue that give you more experience. They all give you a baseline of the same reputation. And so you remember back in Legion, whenever you would kill a blue elite world quest, you'd get like 300 rep. Well, in BFA, that doesn't happen anymore. And I don't think that the Paragon boxes in Legion were, from retrospective, as somebody who's farmed out every single one of the mounts, I do not think that they were bad for them to have mounts in the game. But I do think that it would be bad if they did the same thing with the BFA ones, because the BFA world quests take substantially longer and are less rewarding and give you reputation at a much slower rate. That's what I think. If you didn't have them, you change your mind? Well, the reason that I do have them, Pyromancer, is because I farmed them out for hours. Like, I farmed out those boxes for hours off.
These work in much the same way. If you are exalted with a reputation, then you'll get a
they only give you pets
1,000
now.
Reputation bar. Each time you fill the bar, you get a box of loot. Now, this will contain some war resources, some Azerite, plus
Azerite.
Some extra rewards. Now, they're not limited to just toys and pets. There's also some new inscription recipes, one for a water elemental skin, and then reputation contracts.
Azerite.
For the 7th Legion and Honorbound. Now, that
about
said,
that?
Blizzard got the memo from players that they did not enjoy mounts being in the Legion version of the Paragon boxes, so it's good to see that that's not happening again. Overall, though, I just hope the Blizzard make these rewarding enough. I hope they have a good amount of gold, resources, and Azerite. Sometimes the...
Oh, boy, I got a new pet! Look at this! Oh, that looks like the other pet. No, because this one's gray and the other one was black. Ooh, look at me. I'm special now. Wow! Nobody gives a fuck about combat pets.
Those incidental rewards in the game feel a little bit stingy. It's not a massively core problem, but I think that would help them feel more generally rewarding than the Legion versions. So, that's the boxes covered, but let's get to the real meat of this video, and we'll kick that off with the GCD. So Blizzard talked about 8.1 bringing many utility and movement spells off the GCD. Now, you'd make...
The exact opposite thing that they said they were going to do.
You'd think from this, like, it'll be multiple per class. Well, Blizzard posted a current list of abilities that are coming off the GCD, but they were very clear to say that the list was not complete. So, with that in mind, we've got Vengeful Retreat for Havoc, Wild Charge for Druids, Charge and Intercept for the Warriors, as well as Ignore Pain for Prot, which is a big yes, and then Harpoon for Survival Hunters.
Man.
Now, look, that's all great. I totally agree with those changes.
Tomorrow's gonna be fun.
And it's good to see, but it's nowhere near enough. And we do know that more are coming, and I typically would not mind not knowing. But it does kind of make you wonder where the development of this patch is, because it's a few days before the patch launches, this isn't on PTR, and Blizzard still don't have a complete list of GCD changes. And we've got to bear in mind, these are core class changes for many players, and they really, really do matter. It's just strange that they can't give us a complete list. It does kind of feel like a lot of this patch is being cobbled together towards the end, which is kind of odd, because
the reason that we don't know what's going to be in the patch is because they don't know what's going to be in the patch. And even whenever they do know what's going to be in the patch, there are bugs, and nobody knows what's going to be in the patch.
As 8-1 is releasing far later in the BFA cycle than 7-1 did for Legion. Now, overall for me, this is not a reason to be overly angry or anything, it's just a bit confusing that Blizzard seemed to be kind of behind in a few of these decisions. Next, the Battle of Dazara Lore. So, it's the new raid, and we now know when it's going to unlock. Dazara Lore will be playable on Normal and Heroic mode on the 22nd of January, with Mythic and LFR Wing 1 opening up on the 29th, then we see LFR Wing 2 on the 12th of February, and Wing 3 on the 26th. It's hard to predict what's going to happen after that for the game, but we can do some guesswork, and I love this stuff. So first, Ian said...
The 22nd of January. That's more than a month from now.
That 4 to 5 months is about right for a raid tier. Now, bear in mind that the team have decided to move away from massive 12 to 14, boss tiers.
So they didn't decide to do that. They fucked up. And they didn't fuck up this time around, at least not with the raids. Anything bad you can say about, like, WoW, like, yeah, okay, sure. But the raids in Legion and also the raids in BFA, I think the release cycle is much better than we ever had before, right? Outside of, like, Burning Crusade, whenever all the raids just came out on day one and you could just do them whenever you wanted. I thought that was better, but for the most part, I'm happy with what they're doing now.
I think that's actually a great time frame, and I love the size of the current raids. I think that's spot on. So Uldir launched on the 4th of September, and its final day is going to be the 22nd or 21st of January. That means that Uldir will have been out for 141 days, which is 4 months and 19 days. That's right on the money in terms of schedule.
Not quite.
Now, if we're to assume that Dazara Lore will last for 5 months, so, you know, we'll throw another 2 and a bit weeks in to give a conservative estimate, then that would have the Ashara raid of patch 8.2 arriving on Saturday, the 22nd of June. So we'll move that back to, say, the Tuesday, and that would have our next raid release after Dazara Lore being the 18th of June.
All right.
Now, that's okay, but we do know that raid and world content release dates kind of do line up. So during Legion, there was like a tick-tock. There'd be some world content, then 2.5 months, then a raid, then 2.5 months, then world content. So if we're to take that 2.5 month duration, then that would have us venturing to Najatar on either the 9th of April or the 16th of April. So that would be new world content on the 11th of December with 8-1, and then new world content again on the 9th of April with 8-2, which would be a gap of 120 days, which is 3 months and 30 days. That's a little quicker than normal, actually, but
that's a while,
I'm not sure
man.
It's going to feel that way to players, because when you look at the content of 8-1, it's kind of odd. The Karazhan patch of Legion was labeled as a minor patch, yet it had the 10-week Suramar story, it had new world quests, big new dungeon, a bunch of other changes. Well, 8-1
that
seems
raid was
to be filling
amazing.
A 7.2 size slot in the schedule, but kind of with a bit less content. Now, there's there is a raid there, obviously, but there's no dungeon, there's nothing like the Mage Tower, nothing like the class mounts, plus no new zone like the Broken Shore, and it does kind of feel to
me
like
we got the new dungeon, too. I forgot about that.
If I'm going to be honest with you. Now, we'll have to see what the war campaign brings, but from seeing the WoWhead videos, it does appear to be more of the same, so a bit less than the Suramar stuff. Now, I suppose I'm a bit worried that world content won't be able to hold the fort for long enough. And it also does feel a little bit late. And when you look at the comparative release dates of 7-1 and this, it kind of seems late. Now, they did want it to come out a bit later because they felt like 7-1 was too short. But it seems to me that this would have been ideal for, like, the week after BlizzCon. But I'm kind of assuming that the changes
that would have been great
to the launch,
such that would have
been
amazing.
Expeditions and stuff like
Holy shit!
I think that they are what has bumped this patch back pretty much a month.
Yeah.
Now, as for the raid itself, well, I've got to take Preach's word on it because I haven't done testing. and I trust him in the raid stuff. So when he Preach says said he it likes looks like a really, really good raid, that's enough for me to be excited. And that definitely is great news for the raiding players. But with that covered, let's talk about Season 2, because Blizzard have also detailed the season changeover and how that works. So, unsurprisingly, Battle for Azeroth Season 2 begins on the 22nd of January, along with the raid releasing. Now, Season 2 is going to bring loads of changes.
I'll stream that day for sure.
First, gear and item level rewards will just increase across the board, as will the difficulty of content, such that they'll both line up. And that just operates in the exact same way as it did with Legion. So your normal, heroic, Mythic Zero, Mythic Plus item levels will all...
I want to say another thing. Is that it's not necessarily because the content in 8.1, there's not enough content. That's not the problem at all. The problem is that the content that's being added and the content that's currently in the game is not fulfilling to people. If they made the core content more fulfilling, you wouldn't have people crying for a new patch every other week because they run out of things to do so quickly and there's no fulfillment or reason or motivation for them to continue doing the same things over again. There's no progression of content anymore. All content is on a flat line, and you can access all content in the game without having to really do anything. Like, if you have average level gear, there is no content in the game that is exclusive to people with better gear. There's nothing really to strive for. The only thing that you strive for is doing the same content that you've already done before at a higher level. Doesn't really mean a lot.
Be bumped up along with mob health and damage. Then the Titan Forging cap will go up, and the item level reward ceiling from world quests and all of that stuff will also go up. And that includes things like your Azerite and your weapons as well, which I presume will, maybe like your emissaries. Azerite will be like maxing out at 385 or something like that. Now, this is also when the new Azerite gear is going to start dropping. Now, that's the gear that's got the fifth ring and it's got traits from the new and greatly improved pool. So, on the whole, it's going to be a lot better and will also benefit from
the
reforging costs halving every 24 hours and us all getting a cost reset on patch day. Now, there is an odd thing that kind of does lead us into the next topic, and that is uncertainty, because it's been a very confusing PTR that does sort of line up with a very confusing beta test for this expansion. During beta, it was
It's the old gods that are confusing the Blizzard developers, and that's why the patch cycle is unclear. It's because they're under corruption. And it's the same thing with some of the achievements, right? Is it like the achievements in Aldir, it was intentionally wrong because the achievement itself was corrupted by the old gods.
Kind of hard to know what was intended, because things would change a lot, but Blizzard wouldn't really do posts to tell us why, or really what their design goals were. And this meant that it was very hard to provide feedback on systems, because we didn't really know the big picture. Now, I would overall think that the fallout from these sort of weak communications is what did most of the damage for BFA. Because sure, Blizzard might make a whoops, that's totally normal, but if communication's good, then we can work with them.
That's a lot of whoops.
Better. Well, when players don't really know what Blizzard want out of their systems, it's kind of hard to give feedback. Now,
yep.
8.1 has been kind of similar. Take those GCD changes. It's a little crazy that they can't provide a list that's, you know, a full list of changes a few days before the patch comes out. Like,
that's
this
because
stage,
they don't know what it's going
to
be.
Nice to have.
They're shooting from the hip. They have no idea what they're doing.
Like that. It does
it's obvious.
Just feel like things are a little bit rushed and chaotic. Now,
yeah.
Their preview posts are fine. They're great, but they are kind of lacking in details. Assaults give you an XP buff. How much XP? We have the new Azerite currency, but right now there's the blue post explaining, from a few days ago. But before that, on the PTR, we had some really strange numbers, and they seemed strange for weeks. It is great to know how that is now, where the currency costs will increase once Season 2 kicks off. And that totally makes sense, and I agree with them doing it that way. But I think it would have been great if that had have came out at the same time that they updated the numbers on the PTR, so that the PTR testers could have given better feedback. Overall, it's just been a frustrating PTR. There's been a lot of unknown factors, and I think it's been hard for players to give really good feedback.
I don't think
feedback.
I've been on a
and
PTR ever since, like,
I do
Legion,
think Blizzard are in a position where they need good feedback on their game and its systems. But if they're making it hard for players to give good feedback, then it's tricky. I mean, even with assaults, we have no idea what their intended pacing is. Now, they said daily in the Survival Guide video, but that's pretty loose. We have no numbers, and from the PTR, we think that's just for testing. Now, in an industry that's mainly, like these days, you know, live service titles, they do seem kind of uniquely a bit confused and not great at communication when compared to the competition.
What was that game?
Now, given how Blizz are a big, gargantuan company,
I think,
personally, that it's down to them having a rigid internal structure. You know, loads of red tape, because I know there's loads of really brilliant people
This is what
there,
I've been saying for weeks.
I just don't think their output is, like, up to what I think they can do. So, perhaps their management needs to cut some red tape to let their staff be a little bit more free to communicate with players and testers. Okay, so it would not be a week of Warcraft without a bit of a drama, so let's break down the response to 8.1. Honestly, I was a little bit surprised when I saw the survival guide so hard, and I asked people on Twitter what they thought. And, you know, the responses were the quality of the game, its systems, the nature of the content, and then Brigade and hate mobbing. And I found the latter point kind of interesting, because I do think that it can be popular to dislike something, and indeed there can be a social incentive to continue not liking something and doing so loudly. But I also think that that effect is basically just an amplifier on something that's already there, on a dissatisfaction that already exists. I don't think that people are hating on BFA purely for the sake of doing so. I mean, some people will do that, but I think it's probably not a statistically significant number, and if we overemphasize the role of the crazies, then I think we give ourselves an intellectually lazy way to discount criticism, and in the process of doing that, we then make ourselves blind and unable to improve.
Wow.
From my personal experience creating...
Why'd you hear that? Let's run that back again. Let's hear that twice, okay, guys? Listen up. Listen up right here.
I don't think that people are hating on BFA purely for the sake of doing so. I mean, some people will do that, but I think it's probably not a statistically significant number, and if we overemphasize the role of the crazies, then I think we give ourselves an intellectually lazy way to discount criticism, and in the process of doing that, we then make ourselves blind and unable to improve. I mean, from my personal experience creating
there
content, I can say that, at least for me, not all good feedback is plight, and not all plight feedback is good. Now, it's fair to say that the effects of strong negative feedback being popular, I think they are more pronounced than normal. Diablo Immortal was not handled great by Blizzard. They just let it fester. They didn't openly talk about what happened. As for BFA, well, it still is the case that there
are
many
problems in the game. But
they talked
to random news sites
that were first pointed out.
Oh, we're surprised. They didn't like it.
I mean, credit to those who did.
Fire whoever told you to be surprised.
Because they sure as hell copped onto that faster than I did. Now, if I was to think back, it was probably down to me just kind of having hopes in those systems and there'd be a more full picture towards the end of beta, but that didn't really happen. We didn't really get max level PvE pre-mates to test the endgame content. Now, as for that chunky dislike bar on the survival guide, well, from my perspective,
we don't get fooled again.
Legitimate. I think Blizzard have made iterative updates and improvements to things that players in many cases wholesale reject. Now, that's an uphill battle that the dev team are going to have to grapple with. Many just don't like Azerite because of how it came at the cost of their classes. You know, not getting new spells and having talents and stuff basically be put into Azerite as an external reward system. Now, the acquisition changes are great, and I wholly believe that this is a better version of the Azerite system, but it's not fundamentally different in its nature. So to the players who look at their classes and they feel sad, 8.1's not really going to help.
No.
Azerite perhaps inadvertently managed to handbrake turn the game in a direction away from where those players wanted it to go. Now, as for other things, well, I think islands have been a bit of a dud. By all accounts, the new ones are pretty decent, and the broad changes are
great. I've probably done
more
islands than
most
people.
And the reward changes seem great, too.
I don't hate islands,
they're still islands,
actually.
So it's a gameplay experience that people kind of know of. It's not transformatively different. So while the changes are welcome, I don't think it's going to massively excite players who dropped them out of the expansion or cause them to change their minds. As for the Warfronts, well, it's just another Warfront. And you know, it's really funny because I was
another
looking back
Warfront?
At Wintergrasp for my Wrath.
Oh my god.
I played Wintergrasp in the day.
That's
a
it,
balance
man.
Balance mess is what it was. But I think it managed to pull off the Warfront fantasy quite a bit more effectively. Yeah. I think that's because it was less scripted and less, it wasn't instanced, and that made it feel kind of real. Warfronts don't.
Yeah.
And I think that's why adding another one just doesn't really excite people.
The reason why Wintergrasp was more of a Warfront than a Warfront is because Wintergrasp had a lose condition. How can it be a Warfront? It's like, do you have a war with an ant? No, because you just stomp on the ant. It's over. You already know what's going to happen. It's like you can't have a war with something that it's like you can't have a war with a cardboard box. Because you just do what you cut it in half and you put it in a recycling bin, it's done. There's no lose condition with a cardboard box.
Too much. They're not particularly fun, and while I have actually got some hope for the heroic mode, the difficulty for the current ones
isn't
really
going
to excite people. Then as for the assaults, they are just more quests. Now,
wait a second.
They will make BFA leveling a bit
Let
more
me go back. Let me go back to
for
that.
The current one.
We'll also be introducing heroic warfronts where you and 9 of your friends can enter a warfront as a team, play at a higher difficulty, and collect new epic rewards. So they're scaling it down to 10 players. But why? Are Warfronts so at their very core coded to have half of the people AFK that you can't figure out how to make 20 people go into Warfronts? Like I
It's not really going to excite people. Then, as for the assaults, they are just more quests. Now, they will make BFA leveling a bit more fun, and they'll break up the pace there, and I think they are significantly better designed than their Legion counterparts. So these are all positive things,
Okay,
but at the
I
end of the
haven't done them.
day,
We'll
they're
see.
just not a new place to journey to or a new type of gameplay experience. And I also think the Blizzard, as I said, are maybe trying to fill a 7.2 sized gap with a 7.1 sized patch that just has a raid on the side.
It's too
And that's
small.
going to be challenging because I don't really see something equivalent to the Suramar campaign in the War campaign. Now, of course, 7.1 was described as being a minor patch. Well, 8.1 is being described as a major patch, so, a 5.2 instead of a 5.1. Now, I'm not super sure what to make of this currently, and I suppose I'm just a little bit worried that the content won't keep people satiated until Nashatar.
Well, it
And I
won't because
actually suspect that Mechagon might have
it's
been delayed,
hollow.
because if patch 8.1 had a new
It's
area to go
hollow.
to and a new
Wait.
dungeon, I think it would be perceived as being a lot larger. It would give people somewhere new to explore, something that feels new. And I think that would have made people more excited. So overall, that's why I think the reactions to 8.1 have been the way that they have been. The patch is kind of like it's roster updates to existing systems and a
Yeah.
slightly updated version of a Legion system, plus some iteration on systems that a large segment of the player base happened to disagree with on a first principles basis. So it's a very challenging place for the team to be in. And I guess on a more personal note, I feel bad for them because, they're breaking for the holidays now, and they're going to the holidays with the knowledge that they've had a rough time at work, and their job's not going to be easier when they get back. Now, I can't let that override my criticisms of their output or cause me to run defense of them,
Happy
but I
birthday
think
to
it
the
is just
ground.
worth keeping in mind the the
That's the
human
subs.
element and what's going on from the other direction, because I'm pretty sure that they're not thrilled about how all of this is going, and it probably is the case that this is a larger negative influence on their own personal lives than it is on ours, because this is something we do in their in our spare time. But for many of the devs, this is something they do in work and then also when they go home. So to have that thing be not in a great, position, I think, there is a bit of a role for empathy there when it comes to the developers, and I'm all for criticizing the game very.
I feel bad for the developers, but I wouldn't need to if they just developed the game the way that obviously a lot of people in at least the outspoken player base feel that it should be.
Stridently when it comes to its ideas and stuff like that. But sometimes, it does descend into not the most productive things, calling people out and stuff like that. And I just don't really think that helps. So there you go.
Not
That's my
really.
thoughts on the player response to patch 8.1, as well as a bunch of news updates for what's going on with the patch. So yeah, let me know what you think about 8.1. I've already asked the people on Twitter. It was super interesting reading everyone's responses. So let me know down in the comments below. I will be reading them. And the next thing I recommend you to do if you have a bit of spare time is to check out the Wrath of the Lich King documentary. I really enjoyed making it. It's one of my favorite
Oh yeah,
bits of
we watched that.
content
That was a good
ever.
video. I
And
liked that a lot.
the plan is to give
I
Wrath a
think this
fair
is
shake of the stick and.
what I like about Belior is that enough that there are a lot of people that think that he's a shill, right? Which in my mind, I don't think he's a shill. I think Belior gives a reasonable, level-headed evaluation based off of his experience of also being a game developer, right? He went to school for game development, and I think that like usually the way that he approaches things is very well put together, and I agree with it a lot. Let's see what this is here, okay? I want to read this real quick before we start Dark Souls, all right? Give me one second. This is quite a yikes for the dev team. What do you think the core reasons are? Internet hate boner is strong, just to be mob mentality, shrug. So there's actually nothing wrong with the game. There's nothing at all wrong with the game. Everything is completely fine. And I just like how can you say that? All of this has happened before, it'll happen again. I don't know why. Like I want to see these people, like the people that make these posts. I want to see what their slash plate is at 120. I want to look at how much content they've completed at 120. What have you done in the game? How many aspects of the game have you experienced and do you enjoy? Right? How many times do you play? Because I think that a lot of these people, like, they don't like it, right? And it's so frustrating for me to see. No, boss. Well, it's not about, like, I just want to see what the slash plate is, right? How much time do you spend playing the game? Like, what have you done in the game? I don't know.